Good? All righty. So thanks again for having me. My name is Crouse. I work with Raytheon Cyber Product Company. I'm not with Raytheon. I am with Raytheon, but you're not going to see me talk about missiles. You're going to see me talk about planes. You're not going to see me talk about boats. Actually, Raytheon has a small cyber products company. If you follow the big chain, Raytheon in Boston, Mass., all the way down, you're going to find us in a cyber products company. So one of our products within that company that we like to focus on is insider threat. So, but instead of going into a sales pitch on a product, I'm going to talk to you more about the problem of insider threat. I'm going to talk to you about what I see from an awareness point of view in insider threat, and talk to you a little more about what the definition maybe of a privileged user is and privileged users within your organizations. So without further ado, let's talk stats. We always love to throw out numbers. I think numbers are a good thing because you can put them on a kind of piece of paper. Wow. So one of the things that we, there was a survey done, I think about 5,000 practitioners over 13 different countries did a survey, and they said, hey, where are your losses associated with insider threat or privileged user abuse? In the past, there's always been a metric for external threats. I think if you look at Symantec, you look at McAfee, you look at everybody out there, they can always quantify what your losses are from an external threat, a hack, a virus, you know, how it impacts your organization. What you're seeing now, part of the corporations, is they're finally starting to give awareness of how to quantify the impact of an insider threat, a privileged user abuse, a breach. So if you look at this case right here, it talked about privileged user fraud. And in essence, it was the idea that a privileged user was selling source code that was causing a problem within an organization. And they equated it to roughly, if you look at a big picture point of view, about $314 billion a year in corporate losses to privileged user fraud. So it's somebody inside, a trusted person on the inside, that is either doing damage against your company, taking stuff away, or anything like that. They had one company in there lost almost 3/4 revenue. They had a huge hit to the brand recognition. This caused them to, the market value to go down significantly. So I like to throw this up there right away because it kind of sets the framework that people are starting to pay attention to what the abuse of a privileged user is, what the abuse of an insider is, and how you can quantify it. In the past, this has been very difficult. So privileged users. So real quick question, show of hands. IT professionals in the room? All right, good. So I'm not attacking IT professionals when I talk about privileged users. So when I identify a privileged user, do not be offended by it. You're going to see kind of what my definition of a privileged user is. We're going to talk a little bit about the risks of it. We're going to talk about ways to mitigate the risks. So who is a privileged user? So you see right there, the privileged users can be anybody. And what I mean anybody, it's anybody with access to company information. Anybody access to the most sensitive information. It could be an IT guy who has the keys to the kingdom. We talked about a little bit about, on the intro, Edward Snowden, who had the appropriate passwords. But it also could be a HR person. It could also be CEO. It could be your finance manager. All those people have access to company's sensitive information. All those could abuse the role that they're currently in right today. So an HR person we've seen in the past could abuse it by saying, look, I have all your privacy information. I could gather the privacy information of all my employees and I could provide that to maybe somebody in the outside, maybe social security numbers, maybe a birth date, maybe credit card information, whatever is accessible in your PeopleSoft. A finance information. Say you have a finance individual, you're a CFO, he's a privileged user because he has access to all the corporate information. He could be providing earnings ratings, he could be providing other stuff to the market before you're ready. So the privileged user is not just the IT person. The IT people get a bad rap. They get a bad rap. Snowden has given the IT guys a bad rap about privileged user abuse because he's in the front page. He's in the first out there. Everybody sees him. But the privileged user person, the abuse that happens, the insider threat, could be anybody. Could be even a developer, an application developer. So kind of keep that in mind as we frame this discussion. What are the risks? This is an interesting one. And a couple things that makes me a little nervous. You see, this is another survey done by about security managers. You see the word empowered and curious? We've seen that people out there that are willing to take chances, willing to take information, willing to do IT sabotage, fraud, we've seen a trend where they feel like they're empowered to do it. They feel like they have a responsibility that they're kind of above the law, that they are saying, hey, I'm above the law. I can go start looking for this information. I can go search for this information. I'm just curious. The word always makes me a little nervous when it's in you have an IT guy or you have a privileged user or anybody else like that. Curious and is always constantly looking for information that maybe his role shouldn't have. One of the things we like to say is that your privileged users, by definition, get privileges. They have access to information that they need to do their job on a daily basis. So the one thing you got to do, you got to protect in, is you got to maybe look at different ways to protect your information. You got to look at different ways to identify people abusing their roles and privileges. And you have to do that to protect the bottom line number, your company's kind of reputation, and anything else that is important to your company. One of the things that we talked about, why are the risks so great? I think after all, you know, you look at all these surveys they do, and there's a lot of surveys that go around, is that some people out there are taking their newfound roles to a new level. And they're looking at ways to, as Carnegie Mellon said, there's three ways that the insider looks at IT sabotage, looks at IP theft, intellectual property theft, and looks at fraud. So you look at these organizations right now trying to protect themselves. You have people that have certain roles within a company. For example, if I am I'm a developer, and I have an opportunity to, I do code, I'm a coder. So my role is I develop code. Should I be out there looking for other information? Should I be out there searching the financial information? Maybe I have the access to this other server. Should I be pinging this server for the information? A lot of people out there go beyond their actual role. So if you look at your technologies, you look at your processes, you really need to look at a person's role and what they're doing beyond their role. Because the risks are great because it's individuals. Insider threats, privileged user abuse, whatever you want to say, really comes down to people. Unlike external threats where it could be machines, it could be systems, your insider threat really comes down to people. It's people that you've entrusted with your company's most sensitive information. It's those people you vetted up front in your vetting process that you said, I trust these people, I've given them a trustworthiness. So you have to continually look at these people over time and make sure they're doing the roles they're supposed to do. They're assigned, they're actually doing these roles year in, year out. One of the questions I had was, let me ask a real quick question in the room. Does anybody know their process when somebody leaves your organization, who is responsible for turning off their accounts? So you have somebody who's assigned to do that. And you have a follow-up, right, to make sure that person turned off all the accounts, turned off all the passwords, turned off everything, changed things? Yeah, so I found some organizations, I asked the same question, and someone goes, yeah, I'm responsible to do it. I was like, who's making sure that you did it? Well, I don't really have anybody doing checks and balances. I was like, what if you forget? They said, well, sometimes I forget. I was, okay. You need to have your checks and balances in place to make sure, you know, those vetting processes, those processes to do the simple things are in place as well. So this is interesting that people always ask me, Mike, well, privileged user abuse is only the government's problem. And oh, by the way, it's only the government's problem, it's only big business's problem. It's only the financials problem. It's only the retail problem. But this slide right here tells you that every organization is at risk. And that's independent of your size of your organization, independent of your organization's kind of in the community. It could be a financing, for example, has a huge risk. I mean, you see that publicly in the papers all the time. You see our government up there, they have a big risk. IT organizations, manufacturing, retail has a big risk. And this is one of the things for retail I don't think people understand. If you have a big retail organization, say you're, who's a big real retail organization in the Boston area? Who's our sponsor? TJX, right? So let's TJX is having a big sales promotion at one of its stores, right? They're gonna they have a marketing plan that's coming out, a big sales marketing plan that they know they need to hit the market hard, and they're gonna do it in June 5th, right? And they know they wanna be first to market with this marketing plan because they're gonna make a big sale. You know, they're gonna put the PS4s on sale for $150. $150 going on sale. wouldn't they want to keep that information close vest? Because they don't want the Walmarts of the world, maybe the Best Buys of the world, to get light of this, because then they would put a counter plan in place to say, hey, you know, they're trying to sell this stuff real quick. We're going to put something in place, you know, to come out on June 20th that's going to trump what they're doing. So retail has to worry about an insider threat, because even in a marketing department, if you leak that information to a competitor, they're going to get an advantage of maybe a jump to the market. One of the things we see working with retailers is vendor collusion. That's a big point out there for kind of a trusted user. And vendor collusion, does anybody know kind of what that is? Real quick? Huh? Vendor collusion. So, real quick. Say I'm selling, I like to always use gloves. I'm selling gloves to a big worldwide distributor. And I am working with you and saying, hey, you know, you come in, you say, I'm going to give you $5 for those gloves. And I want to buy a million gloves. And I say, man, you know, I really want... Give me six. I was like, you give me six, and I'll take your, you know, I got a great place in Barbuda, you know, that your family can, I'll set you up, all expense trip to Barbados, and I got a 4 or 5 star resort that'll hook you up. You know what I mean? You're thinking to yourself, okay, it's going to cost, all right, I got a nice trip off that. And you say, okay, I'll give you six. Okay? That happens. Then a company costs, company what? If they buy a million, that costs $1 million. They buy 10 million, that's 10 million bucks. That's the bottom line. So you got to be careful, even in the organizations, even in the companies that you wouldn't think have information to protect, even a place like that is costing coming off the bottom line. So that's what the slide in a kind of a long-winded play is saying, that privileged user abuse, insider threat is not just with one organization. It's not just with the United States government. It's not just with the intelligence agencies. It's across the board. Mitigating the risk. So one of the things that we talked about, and I'm going to get to before, is that you should, in mitigating the risk, there's a lot of problems out there, a lot of ways to get data out of your organizations. But one of the things I'd like to say is that let's not complicate the solutions you put in place. First of all, there's some very simple steps you can do. One of the things first out of the box is that if you're an organization and you want to mitigate the risk of an insider, privileged user, you need to invite to the table more than just IT, more than just security. The problem is everybody's. The problem is HR's. The problems are CEOs. The problem is vault IT. And problem is legal. Bring in legal. Bring in all these stakeholders up front. They need to be up front. They need to be part of your team up front, because they're the people who are going to be setting the requirements, basically what you need to protect, what's important to your company. They're going to help you put together a plan and a process that's going to fit your organization, because one size doesn't fit all. You know, don't use a plan that, you know, for example, that wasn't put in place for a large organization. You might want to tailor it. But you need to bring those people together under one umbrella. And make it simple. Keep it common sense. Keep it to the point where you're using technologies appropriately. But you have to do planning up front if you're going to mitigate. This is a kind of a nice way to put a kind of a building blocks. Identify stakeholders, bring them to the table, identify requirements. And then at some point you get to maybe a technology that could help you with your problem. When I say that, technology is not the sole answer. So if you're out there looking inside a threat privileged user and you go, you know, you got a brief from a cool sales guy, he comes in, he tells you about this product he has, he goes, I'm going to solve your problem. I got this widget that if you put this on your network, on your workstations, your problem solved. I've got the solution. I've got the silver bullet. If they tell you that, you know, first of all, you should look at them and go, well, there's the door, you know, because there's no silver bullet. Okay, so just be careful. Technology can help. Technology is a necessary device to help you inside a threat, but technology alone is not the answer. And picking out the right technology is what needs to happen. So a lot of technology today, if you look at the information, external threats are really built to protect against kind of external threats that are trying to get in. You have your you know, your antivirus, you have your Nortons out there, you have your Symantecs, you have McAfee. You also have SIMs, like ArcSights, QRadar, you know, taking a lot of logs from computers and all that stuff. All those were really built for kind of the information assurance world, you know, kind of in a networking world. You have to look at different way to approach insider threat privileged user, because remember when I said the privileged users are people? They're not technologies. So you really need to understand the intent of an individual as he's manipulating the data or as he's accessing your data. You have to also look at the behavior he has when he's maybe at his workstation. So the technologies need to get into more context of a data, more the intent. And an interesting story about technologies that I'll kind of bring up to you. DLP solutions. We had a customer that came to me. It was actually I think a government customer that DLP data leak prevention logs gave me about 8,000 data leak prevention logs, and came to me and said, "Mike, I have a problem." And I was like, "Whoa, what's the problem?" He goes, "My IA shop, my IT, this file that had 8,000 DLP entries, basically 8,000." Events or alerts that came up that said people were moving sensitive data to a USB or data to a USB. And I was like, wow, okay, that's a problem. He goes, yeah, what should I do about it? I was like, what were they moving? He goes, I don't know. I don't know what they were moving. I was like, okay, I mean, he goes, but I know they moved something. And I was like, so what do you want me to do? Well, we need to go do something. We gotta do something. We gotta run out. We gotta go investigate. I was like, but we're gonna invade 8,000 and they're all over the country and all over the world. He goes, yeah, but this red pie chart, this red green pie chart is telling me I have a problem. I need to do something. And I kind of told him, I was like, where's your context? Where's the data behind that that tells you what was moved, why it was moved? Was it moved because that's that person's job? Or was it moved to kind of hide something? Was it moved from malicious intent or non-malicious? Where's the back behind? Where's the intent? Where's the context? Where's the information that can kind of substantiate those you got? And he goes, I don't have that. Somebody just dropped this on my desk and my commander, my general said, I need to do something. I need to do it now. So you kind of put yourself in his place. I mean, it's like, so I kind of said, okay, what can we do about it? So one of the things that I kind of need to get into, and this is, there's plenty of technologies that do this today, but one of the things we've seen very effective for it is that you kind of have to start looking at the host at the endpoint. Because you really look at what a privileged user does, or even a insider threat does, he's really interacting with his computer and what he's doing, what information he's pulling off a file share, pulling off another directory, searching online, emailing to people, encrypting it. Any information that has, it's really happening on the host. It's happening on the endpoint. And this is where you can see somebody's intent and their malicious behavior. You can actually see that if somebody on purposely was trying to move company sensitive information to a USB versus making a mistake. It's one thing if you go into a organization and you say, I made a mistake, boss. What'd you do? I said, I didn't mean to move that file over to that USB and take it out of the company and bring it home with me. And you're like, oh, okay, you made a mistake. But if you're not where the actions happen, and you're not able to look at maybe that person turned off his NIC card, maybe he renamed that file, maybe he changed wording in that file, trying to cover his tracks, you wouldn't get the intent that he was being malicious or non-malicious. So that happens at the endpoint. That happens here in the user space. So when you're looking at technologies, you need to look at technologies that not only protect from external threats, but internal threats, and you need to have complementary tools that take advantage of your technologies of today, and then you bring in complementary tools. So you kind of see where that's going, that whole direction. So one of the things, I'm gonna bring up a couple stories here I think is very interesting, is that I had a retail organization that, this happens all the time, was gonna lay off about having a RIF, a reduction in force. And was going to lay off about 100 people within the organization. So they brought in everybody in the organization and they said, all right, we're giving you a great severance pay. So they gave them like 6 months, some a year severance. That's a great severance. Think about it. It's a nice little severance package. And they said, the only thing that you need to do is you can't start taking any company proprietary information. You can't take movies, you can't take programs, you can't take software. And they said, okay. So we had a product, we have a product called Shervy, which is an endpoint solution that fits within this model. So we added on there on all those workstations out there. We work on the host. We noticed right away, the company called us and said, you never guess what happened. I was like, what? They go, probably 80% of those people, the first thing they did, the RIF notice, they went right through their workstation, started downloading information. They were posting it on eBay, posting it on Amazon. They were selling stuff all over left and right. So what they did is they brought these individuals in one by one, and they said, well, did you do anything, you know, when you got your RIF package? They go, no, we didn't touch anything. We didn't do anything. And they brought him in, and they showed him kind of a, and I'll show you this a little bit, like a video replay of their incident. One of the things we do on our product, Shervy, is we can take a video replay of your computer, and it can kind of play back like a DVR. So it can see you moving the mouse around. It can see you bringing, dropping things down there. So they played this for him. And they were like, and they said, is that you? Yep. Okay, would you sign this? And they said, what do you mean you signed? Oh, that's your termination, immediate termination. You've forfeited your severance pay. So you think about it from a company's point of view, yeah, that's a great return on investment for being able proactive and having, you know, not only their external tools but internal tools in place to protect them in the bottom line. So that's kind of an interesting story in a retail organization. I thought was, it's real world, shows the return on investment. It shows them how you can, you know, if you plan your technologies right, how you can kind of protect yourself. My closing remarks real quick. Thing to keep in mind, privileged users are everywhere. What I mean, they're everywhere. They're not just in your IT guys. They are financial guys. They could be HR. You just have to put the right protections in place, the right technologies in place, the right processes in place to deal with it. But the privileged users are out there. It's getting, like I said, it's getting, the awareness is getting there, meaning that we're trying to bring awareness to CIOs. But, you know, every conference I go into, I think I get another CIO that says, wow, I need to protect myself. I didn't know this stuff was happening. Don't be afraid to look. Don't be afraid to look. Privileged users have privileges. That's the key. That's their job. They're sometimes a superman organization. There's no reason why you can't audit, monitor. You can't look at what your supermen are doing. They shouldn't feel like you're violating their privacy. You're just doing it at work. You know, you're looking at what they're doing at work. So don't be afraid. No organization is immune. We talked about that. You know, large, small, everybody has information to protect. Identify what your information you have to protect. It's all sensitive information for you. It doesn't have to be classified. It can be company proprietary. Everybody has information that they don't want to get out. They want to control. Identify that. Create a plan. Start from your scratch. Get your plan in place. Buy technology that makes sense. One of the secrets also is, hear this come about, is look at your technology you have in place in today. I was talking to somebody the other day over at the speaker greet and meet the other day, and we talked about using technologies. Actually, take your technology that you have in place today and might want to configure them properly. A lot of people buy a lot of stuff and it sits on a shelf. I don't know how many times I went into customers and they said, Mike, I bought these 20 different tools. I was like, how many did you put in place? None. I was like, how many are configured properly? I don't know. So take an inventory of what you have in place today. If you need to complement it with other tools, complement it with other tools. But take an inventory. Common sense, that's a big thing. Common sense, it doesn't have to be complicated. Use common sense when you're looking at that. Protect your people's privacy, but use common sense when you're putting together a good plan. Okay? So I think I'm doing pretty good on time. One of the things I am going to kind of bring to you, and this is, I'm going to play you a little vignette. So this is a scenario, privileged user steals data. So we do this like little vignettes. It's a 3-minute video. It shows you what a privileged user could do and then how a technology like Shervy could help, you know, endpoint auditing, monitoring it. So look at this scenario as potentially something that could happen within your organization. And then, you know, how we might address it with technology. By the way, Defense Technology Acquisition Agency is a made-up term. We also have another one called FJEA. I think Federal Justice Environment Agency or something like that. So we like to make up government agency names. We figured at some point they're going to start using our government agency name because the government seems to create new names every day. So if you see DTAA come up, that was ours to begin with. We didn't trade. So I'm not going to give the government that one. So
presumably the NSA in Hawaii did not have your product.
No, they did not have our product. They did not have our product. It's all right. I'm going to bust out of here for a minute and go. And you're going to hear a different voice, so bear with me for one.
Demonstration uses fictional Defense Technology Acquisition Agency, DTAA, to walk through a typical corporate and government scenario. The following scenario is associated with a DTAA program protected by the cover name Cinnamon Crisp. Cinnamon Crisp protects the acquisition of a highly sensitive radio receiver a government organization requires. 3 weeks ago, Shoreview detected Joe, a Cinnamon Crisp design engineer, posting his resume on several external job search sites. People planning to leave a company represent a higher than normal insider threat risk. A CyberArk software study revealed 71% of people surveyed said they would take proprietary corporate data with them. Because of this, DTAA has placed Joe in a high-risk group in Shoreview to enable a more focused observation. Joe knows the technical details of the Cinnamon Crisp program. He's been in charge of the design specifications for the Cinnamon Crisp device and has authored significant parts of the specification document. He routinely has access to very sensitive data that DTAA needs to protect. Something Joe has done triggered an alert in Shoreview. Reviewing the DVR replay reveals Joe's actions. We see Joe opening up a corporate file share and accessing the Cinnamon Crisp specification document. Though Joe attempts to evade detection by disconnecting from the network, Shoreview records the action. Now he's renaming the document to something more innocuous. Now he's encrypting it. He's emailing the renamed file to his home account. It may be against company policy to email encrypted documents outside of the organization, but without Shoreview revealing Joe's every action, Joe could easily talk his way out of the violation, stating the document he was sending had personal credit card information and he did not want to send it in the clear, or something to that effect. This scenario goes to the heart of security measures meant to protect your company. Just because Joe posts his resume doesn't mean he is definitely an insider threat. We can't just take the approach of cutting off his access to the sensitive documents he needs to do his job. At the same time, we need to be able to monitor, audit, and investigate when we have an insider threat. Shoreview enables you to effectively monitor your network for potential insider threats and provides context to infractions. This context gives more insight on whether a good judgment of trustworthiness regarding specific employees has been made, and it shows the effectiveness of policies for right-sizing permissions.
So that was just a scenario that could potentially be in anybody's organization. One of the benefits there about being on the endpoint, you got pre-encryption. You also saw somebody's intent. So if you saw that scenario play out within your organization, would you consider that that's somebody who's trying to maybe bring it, kind of hide his tracks, right? Not being, you know, upfront with the company. So that's one of the advantages of having technology that's on the endpoint. You see pre-encryption, you see the intent, you see the person manipulating the data in any way they can. Yes.
Document Joe was working with was the specification of Cinnamon Crisp, which was a hacked
yes.
Product. And how could he was able to rename it? It's only part of the protection of the document.
Well, he oh, you mean like why wasn't a document locked down?
Yeah.
Well, Joe was a developer that needed to get to that spec. He needed to do his job. That's part of his job. He was a developer that he needed to, you know, use that specs and for his job, for his system development. So it's once again, it's his role that he should have access. Yeah, well, but it might not even be classified. He could also maybe take a you know how that goes, wrong classification level. But he also could have maybe taken a snippet of that document out and just copied it and it pasted it into an IAM session and sent it out. There's a lot of stuff you can do with the documents. You can always lock down documents. You know, I know there's software down there that can lock it down permissions. But the idea is that if a person's role is that they need access to that information to do their job day in and day out, you kind of have to take that balance between business workflow and security. I mean, one of the things that happened in the DoD whenever they said, no more USBs. Remember that? Remember that when they had, I think it was a WikiLeaks one. I think it was WikiLeaks that said, DoD is going to ban all USBs. Okay, that's a security knee-jerk reaction that you're going to take. But when they put it in practice, they were like, the people were like, I can't get my job done. You know, the people that really legitimately had business reasons to move data, you know, they couldn't do their job. So then they slowly but surely took those security benefit things away. So now it's more opened up again. So you have to balance, you know, the security part with the business workflow. You have to, you know, there's a balance. Monitoring, I think, is a good way to do a passive monitoring because your business workflow can still get the job done, but if you can monitor somebody's role and you can have analytics in the background as looking at somebody's role and if they have access to that information, I think you can get best of both worlds there.
So I'm guessing that you must keep, when it comes to full screen video capture.
Yes.
You must keep that in some kind of a ring buffer and then only save it when an alert or a violation takes place.
Yep.
Presumably you don't have, trying to save all of that all the time.
Yeah, we have a 2-hour rolling cache on our video recording. So basically we can look an hour back in time and an hour forward in time or that combination of over an incident. So once an incident happened, we can pull it an hour before and say what was the precluding events up to that, and then an hour after that to see what was happening after that. A lot of our customers don't know something's happening, and they like to see what all the precursor events were that happened before that event triggered, because there might have been stuff they missed, and they were like, I didn't know this was happening. I didn't know it. That's how we did it, or that's how they did it, or that's how they moved the data. So yes, we have a rolling buffer, encrypted disk cache that's running on machines.
When the network disconnected and pulling locally,
yes,
to the file cache, what's to stop Joe from destroying those files?
Sure. Basically, all our files are hardened. They're hardened from system admins, so we lock them down. You have to actually have a uninstall from us to lock it down. We have anti-tampering policies that are written against it. Basically, if somebody tries to access those files, we kind of throw up an alert immediately. I would say it's probably not 100% foolproof, because there are very smart people in this world that do hacking for a living. But what I've seen is that we have not seen our disk cache, our encrypted disk cache, being corrupted, being accessed, and being able to be deleted. So we do a lot of agent hardening. We are a company in Salt Lake City. That's where our engineers are at. We have a lot of very smart engineers that like to play. So we kind of set up an area every month and say, go break the agent, go turn it off, go have fun, attack mode. So we find all those, you can turn it off this way, or you can delete it, and then we close that vulnerability. And also we kind of hide in plain space. So we like to hide, you know, even though you can have the, you know, names and that stuff, we hide in kind of, you can rename it, you can put it wherever you want. So, yes?
So I realize that security people tend to be a little bit cynical and sometimes even paranoid.
Yes.
But the fact that 80%, which was the number you cited, mm-hmm. would go start taking data, that suggests to me some deep systemic issues in the corporate culture that probably would never be addressed. Looking at your example from the outside, you know, if people felt motivated and justified to do that, mm-hmm. even in light of what you characterize as a generous severance package, then, you know, there are a lot of other problems going on in that organization.
Yep, and there's a lot of things you have to care. some people do not want to look. We found that a lot of people, you will never find out what's happening in an organization if you're afraid to look. We found our customers, we had one organization that bought our product and put something out there, put a very benign, meaning that you can put policies in place to look at whatever you want, but very benign, and they started getting a lot of information back, and it scared them. First of all, it scared them that, oh my God, this is happening across our workforce, not on our networks, but across our workforce. And the second was, how do I respond? How do I respond? Because remember, an insider threat program, you nice to get this information out, nice to collect it, but you also need incident response. So how do I handle an incident? It could be as simple as, you know, you could have somebody who's potentially could be an HR violation, could be sexual harassment in the workforce. So you need your program needs to have an instant response and know how to handle it. Who do I hand this off to? If it's an IT problem, I can hand it off to IT security. If it's an HR problem, I got to hand it off to HR. If it's another issue out there, who do I hand it to? Look, don't be afraid to look, and you got to know the instant response.
Yes, I was just sort of wondering about heterogeneous environments with multiple operating systems, multiple devices. I mean, that particular example was, if I'm not mistaken, that was XP.
Yeah. So SureView works, we're with the program.
Right.
Okay. Linux. We work in Linux as well as a Linux server environment as well.
Support in Linux as well?
No, we're just doing more keyboard and processes for Linux. It's more for server-based type stuff. But Windows, every flavor. You can go back to XP through Windows 8, the latest version, 32-bit, 64-bit. We actually work Vista, I hate to say that, 7, any other versions. So our QA is very extensive. So we work all the way back from XP all the way up through the Windows 8, and then all the applications that are associated with Windows in different versions of that, whether it's Lotus Notes, whether it's Outlook. And yes, Lotus Notes. Somebody said something the other day. I think I had a conversation with somebody. Somebody said, you guys look at Lotus Notes? I was like, yes. And they go, oh my God. Raytheon uses Lotus Notes. So if you would like to put a complaint to Raytheon, please, because I hate Lotus Notes. But if we look at Lotus Notes, we look at all the instant messaging clients. We have network ability to look at the network from the host as well.
But not smart devices.
So interesting, smart devices. So we actually are in development right now on looking at a mobile solutions for droids as well as iPads. Droids probably going to be our first kind of entry into the mobile auditing, mobile monitoring.
Right.
Droids will be, and then we're going to move into iPads as well. Only thing that scared me about mobile is the fact that if you're talking about monitoring mobile devices, there's so many, and they're different all over the place. But I'm worried about power. I'm worried about taking your battery, you know, by having another app on there that's running and monitoring. And what are you looking to monitor on your mobile devices, especially with BYOD? We have to be careful about privacy issues. When you're using a corporate asset, it's, you know, you give consent to monitor, consent to audit. But when you bring a BYOD device into it and you're hooking to your corporate Wi-Fi to bring information, how do you ensure that the privacy of those individuals are still they're maintained? So once somebody said, why don't you build a mobile agent? I was like, I could see us building a mobile agent, putting it on your iPhone. And if you got a new iPhone and you had a mobile agent on it and somebody put security said, we have to apply this to your corporate phone. And one day you were able to get 2 days of battery life, and the next day you came in, you're able to get a half a day of battery. What do you think you'd do that phone? You'd probably throw it against the wall, right? Chuck that thing right away, because battery's important, real estate's important. So we have not made it into the mobile. That's probably coming later this year.
I guess one of the other questions for mobile is particularly iOS, is heavily sandboxed.
Mm-hmm.
So can you get into all the different apps that are
right.
running in their own sandbox?
Right. One thing we're doing, we're actually working with another company that was in the Raytheon umbrella and trusted computer company. So we're looking at putting a kind of a trusted client, a virtual image, where all the applications we've hosted on the server and we'd use the only device as a display mechanism. So no applications will be resident on that device. So then you can actually monitor all those apps running at the server level because all you're using your device for, so you could use a BYOD. So if you logged into it and say, I'm going to log into these corporate assets, you just got the display on there and off you go, you know, from that. You can monitor what person's accessing from your company through the server versus being on device. I think that's a better solution than trying to do all on devices, because if you're at the server level, there's a lot more flexibility. You know, then anybody can bring a Droid, they can bring an iPhone, because you're not worried about the applications they use for iTunes. You're worried about people accessing your information. You know, I don't care if he's playing SoundHound and figuring out what that, you know, the music means. You know, but I'd really care if he's accessing my file shares and what information he's viewing on his device. I care about that. So I think doing it from a server might be the better way to approach it to that. You got it. That's the best thing about it. The data's that, data's never resident on the machine. It's just always resident on the server. So I think that's the best solution that we can offer on that one.
So there are some privacy issues here.
Yep.
One set of issues for the United States, maybe a more difficult set of issues in the European Union.
Yep, especially Germany.
They're still working on that EU directive on privacy. How do you address that?
So we're not a vacuum cleaner, so we're not sucking everything off. It's policy driven. So you start with your compliance statement within your corporation. It says when you sign up, when I joined Raytheon, I signed something that said this is the type of compliance. So we start there, write policies around the compliance information. And then case by case, you would might want to increase policy sets based on somebody's role. But the policies are pretty much built on a person's action, and we're not just watching everything. It's based upon behavior that you would do that would be potentially that insider would do.
So that's what I was confused about in your discussion of the video. So if you're not recording all the time and you're waiting for an alert, how do you then back up an hour?
So we're recording all the time, but we're not providing that to the investigators. Okay, we're not providing that.
Okay, so now we're getting into, forgive me for being cynical.
But based on policy.
Doesn't actually mean collect.
Right.
You record. Okay.
So, I mean, and also, too, we're also...
It's writing a text.
Yeah. And also, we're able to exclude things. So a lot of stuff that you can actually tell them what you don't want to collect. So a lot of people, for example, the video really is something they collect when they really have a case or a investigation, what I call focused observation.
Right.
Really, you only want to collect metadata enterprise. If you're deployed to 250,000 workstations, you're not collecting video on everybody. Yeah, you're collecting the metadata. You're collecting the text, the information around it. You only use the video for if you really have an investigation, a focused investigation.
No, I get that.
Yeah.
I'm actually involved in a project that does video.
Yeah. But you can't.
This morning for Bruce Schneier.
No, I didn't miss it.
So basically, he said metadata is surveillance data.
Yeah, it's a lot, and it's context data, and it's a lot of information there. So, yes.
Quick. How does it actually work in terms of implementation? Does it actually take the actual video of the mouse movements, or does it kind of try to reconstruct based on?
Does not reconstruct. Does not reconstruct.
Okay, so it's the actual.
Yes.
Okay.
We tried to reconstruct. And that was too processor intensive, and it actually changed a lot based upon the dynamics of the web pages constantly.
You're shimming the video drive.
Yeah. In essence.
But you're only saving video when an alert fires.
Yes, and when you have a video associated with that policy.
Right.
But if the policy doesn't have video associated, there's no video going to be cached or saved. Just video. Okay. So I think we're one question real quick, and then we're done.
What other vendors other than Raytheon are doing this?
Okay. So for endpoint monitoring there, you have probably 5 or 6 vendors out there. We have a Boston-based company, Vertisys Digital Guardian. So they're right across the street from Raytheon. You have another company called SpectreSoft Pro. So SpectreSoft, if you're a parent and you want to see what your teenager is doing, I would recommend getting SpectreSoft Pro because it's like $20. And it's a nice way to see if your teenager is emailing and what they're doing. So trust me, I've seen that before.
Or if you're involved in a divorce.
Yeah, well, I will take his word on that. So I don't know how to speak for him, but those are some of the endpoint products. There's more and more coming. But it's very hard working in the endpoint because, as this gentleman said, the dynamics of the endpoint you know, changing applications. Firefox changes once every week their application. So you have, there's a lot of QA to get involved. Okay? Make and install your own video driver. So I would have to get an answer for you on that one. Good question. I would have to see where we pull from on that, hook from that. Okay? Good question. I'll get an answer on that one. All right. Thanks, everybody. I appreciate your time.
I'm also Raytheon, PBN Technologies.